Thanks very much for this invitation to this wonderful workshop. I want to talk about a recent work, which is based on a paper in archive, you can check. And in particular, it's relation with mirror symmetry stuff. But hopefully, I hope we fix this workshop. So originally, this work is motivated by understanding the problem of quantum D models. And all experts here, so I just briefly say this. Like understanding the mirror symmetry between this kind of symplectic and complex cases. We all know like at genus zero, you relate this continuous rational curves with the variation of Hodge structures. And the motivation for understanding this stuff is to understand what's happening for the mirror of this counting higher genus curves. So that's the problem of higher genus B model. And same thing as asking like, what is the quantization for this kind of variation of Hodge structures on collabial geometry. And that's the original motivation for this work. And it turns out that this is related to a different problem. A second motivation is to understand integrable hierarchies. So let me try to explain what's happening. So let's consider the following simple formula. You look at exponential of u over t, and you expand it. Everybody can compute it. It's 1 plus u over t and a bunch of terms. So what's remarkable about this formula is the following. First, we promote this variable u to be a field with one variable x. And then you introduce a Poisson bracket by saying that the bracket of two fields, ux and uy, is the derivative of the delta function. Then you throw this formula into this kind of thing, like all the terms here become some kind of Hamiltonians. So let me write down formally some Hamiltonians for this field. And you can check that under this Poisson bracket, all these kind of Hamiltonians commute. So you find an infinite many of commuting Hamiltonians. And then you realize, like, oh, this is a dispersionless KdV integrable hierarchy from this simple formula. Now, this is the second motivation for this talk. So I was trying to understand like why integrable hierarchies always kind of thing exist in topological string. And also whether this kind of exponential map is universal. This is a very simple, nice formula. Explains a lot of stuff. So that's the second motivation.
What is the role of the formula e to the u over t?
Yeah, I'll explain.
Okay.
Yeah, that's another motivation. It turns out that these two motivations are very closely related, at least from the B model point of view. So, so I'm going to focus on this topological B model from the point of view of so-called Kodawa-Spencer gauge theory. So around 1994, like physicists like Tsakoti or Grivafa, they proposed that this B model on Kodawa-BL threefold can be described by a gauge theory, and they call this one Kodawa-Spencer gauge theory. It looks very much like a tensor type theory with cubic interaction. And one way of saying this is that this can be viewed as describing a leading cubic vertex of 12-box string field action topological B model. That's one way of saying this. but actually, this string field action involves a whole towers of interactions satisfying B-way master equation. And with Castello, a couple of years ago, we find a full description for this string field action in the B model on arbitrary collabial, and for the appropriate B-way master equation. I'm going to call this theory BCW theory. I'll explain a little bit more later. Somehow, this you can use this kind of gauge theory to describe the full B model. Now, let me come back to the motivation in the beginning. The first one, the higher genus B model can be described by this quantization of this BCW theory in the so-called B-way formalism. I will also explain this formalism soon. Secondly, it turns out that integrable hierarchy will arise in the following way. Let me start with a collabial. and look at a fibration. So it's collabial across a one-dimensional collabial. So we go one dimensional higher and project to the other stuff. So the sigma can be either C or C star or the elliptic curve. So is this already one-dimensional higher? Now, you start with a B model on this product space, and then you borrow some ideas from physics and compactify along this collabial direction. And at the end of the day, you find some kind of effective 2D chiral theory in two dimensions on the sigma. Again, I will explain in more details what I mean by this precisely. Then, this process is compatible with B-wave quantization. You find that the B-wave mass equation for this effective theory exactly describes this integrable hierarchy from on this collabial. Secondly, the formula, exponential formula I explained in the beginning, actually computes the leading effective action for this if you do this compactification. And this is related to Saito's primitive form in the Long-Ginsberg setting, or Baryonikov conserved semi-infinite pyramid map in the collabial setting. They're essentially the same thing. So this primitive form basically replaced this exponential map, which somehow just remembers all of this infinite many of commuting Hamiltonians. Then this quantization somehow gives a dispersion deformation of this problem, and that's the relation to the motivation. So I will explain in detail what's happening for this whole setup. Let me start with some basic notions on this BV stuff. So this BV formism is a general method to quantize gauge theory, arise from physics, to this kind of gauge fixing stuff. So I'm going to fix my notions of a triple, A, Q, and delta, where A is a graded commutative algebra, and Q is a derivation, so square 0, degree 1. And delta is so-called a B-wave operator. It behaves like a second-order operator, square 0, not a derivation. And the failure of being a derivation defines a B-wave bracket, and that's the usual formula. And these two structures are compatible. That's the data I'm going to call a differential B-wave for this triple. So here's the toy model for this guy. I call this one toy model because presumably this is some kind of finite dimensional model. But if you go to, like, in particular, many quantum field theory examples, it's going to be infinite dimensional, and which is much more involved. I'll come back to this issue soon. But anyway, suppose I have a triple VQ omega, which is essentially finite dimensional minus one symplectic DG vector space. So Q defines a differential. Omega is a symplectic form, which is Q closed. And the degree of this one is minus one. That's why it's minus one symplectic. And because of this degree shifting, it identifies the dual of this vector space with the vector space, but it changed the parity a little bit. So it changed bosons to fermions and fermions to bosons. And then you look at the Poisson kernel of this symplectic form. So it's going to be an element of sim2 of this vector space, because under this identification, watch 2 becomes sim2 under the change of a parity. And this is going to be our B-wave kernel. So for this toy model, the differential B-wave algebra that you get come from the following. So you start with an algebra, graded commutative algebra. That's a formal functions on my vector space. So this is my symmetric powers. And this derivation, this differential induces a derivation on this polynomial algebra. So you get a commutative DGA. Then, to get a B-wave op- yes.
Q is just a differential of degree one acting on Z?
Yes. Yeah, just Q is just a differential, yes. Compatible with this symplectic form. Yes. So it induces whatever that is constructed from V, all the tensors and so on, as a derivation. That's a commutative DGA. The next data that I need is basically the B-way operator. So to obtain the B-way operator, basically the B-way operator comes from this B-way kernel. So using this K, by the way, this is under this this identification, the degree of K is actually 1. So the degree is odd. Then this degree 1 Poisson kernel defines the B-way operator by just contracting all the pairs. So from this formula, somehow expressed that the property that this operator is second order, and square 0 because it's degree 1 odd, and it get a differential B-way algebra from this triple. So the process can be expressed by saying that you start from minus 1 shifted digits in Pauli space, get a differential B-way. This is very naive way. And that's our toy model. By the way, just a remark, this process is definitely well defined for Poisson instead of symplectic. I mean, this kernel can be degenerated in general. And in fact, as we will see, the Poisson kernel, the B-way kernel for this topological B model is actually degenerate. And we're going to find a degenerate B-way structure that will come soon. That's our toy model. And then, starting from this triple, I'm going to define a bunch of synthesis which arise from, again, quantization problem in physics. It's like a power series in H bar, let me call I, is said to satisfy quantum B-way mass equation if such a thing holds, like Q plus H bar delta applied to exponential I of H bar equals 0. And if you use the second order property of the B-way operator to express this equation, the same thing as saying this equation, that's a familiar B-way mass quantum mass equation. And somehow, if you go to this classical limit by setting H bar goes to 0, and this term goes away, you find this equation, the Q I naught plus bracket, this B-way bracket equals 0. And this is a classical B-way mass equation. So whenever I say B-way mass equation or quantum classical, always mean solutions of this type. Now, this quantum mass equation basically is a quantum consistent condition. I mean, for quantum field theory with gauge symmetries, at classical level, you see like this equation says like Q plus bracketing with I naught is a nilpotent square zero operator degree 1. So it describes somehow the infinitesimal gauge transformations, like a BRC operator. And in mathematical terminology, this defines basically a so-called L infinity algebra. And that's the classical data. Now let's move on to more serious problem. So I just described a toy model, but in real life, in particular, many interesting examples in quantum field theory, we have to deal with interdimensional geometry. That's become very serious. For example, this from this toy model triple, this vector space, a differential, and this symplectic form, it can be modified to a triple as follows. First of all, this vector space is going to be replaced by this vector space of smooth sections of some vector bundles, all possible smooth sections. So you see, like, this is very infinite dimensional, huge data. But we can work with smooth sections, so this vector space, no problem. So let's move on to see what we're going to have. Secondly, we need a differential of degree 1 on this vector space. In real life, like this operator always comes from some kind of elliptic complex. So this behaves like a Durham complex or the Bull complex and so on. We have an elliptic operator in some way. So this becomes local. So again, this is okay. We can deal with that. Then for the symplectic pairing, in practice, it's always come from a local pairing where for two sections, you first make a pairing to get something you can integrate it on the manifold and then integrate it. So again, this Poisson, this symplectic form become local. That's also okay. Then in our setup to find this differential BUE, we need a dual of this vector space. And then when we started to understand the dual of this vector space, then we have to be a little bit careful about this topology. But again, the dual is described by distributions, and we know what is a distribution. There's no problem for that. Again, when we look at functions on this we can look at the tensors of the dual, whatever. And then if you take care of this topology, we look at this completed tensor product, and this is understood as distributions on the product of the manifold, that's still okay, we can define, no problem. Let's move on. Then to define the B-way operator, you need the B-way kernel, the Poisson kernel for this symplectic pairing. So because the symplectic form comes from integration, the kernel is basically a delta function, which is a distribution supported on the diagonal of the product space. So anyway, this is singular, as you can see. But let's assume working with this setup, and let's move on to see what's going to happen. The serious problem that is called UV problem in physics is the following. Like, this operator is not well defined on this guy. This guy is defined from this tensor product. So in particular, these functions on these fields are given by a bunch of distributions. Then the way we define this the pairing from this BV operator by pairing this kernel with functions on the space, we cannot pair this because K0 is a distribution with singular, and it's also a distribution. The problem is that we cannot pair the two distributions. We can pair a distribution with smooth data, but we cannot pair these two stuff. And this is the place we're going to study to need this the notion of renormalization. This is some kind of celebrated idea in quantum field theory. So there are many ways you can do renormalization. So let me just explain one approach developed by Costello. I'm going to call this one homotopic renormalization. The idea is the following. So the problem is about singular distributions, but the distributions are not very far away from smooth functions up to homotopy. So in particular, the cohomology are the same using this elliptic regularity. So this means that we can replace our singular stuff by something smooth using a particular homotopy. And then you try to remember the original way, original theory in a homotopic way. And that's the basic idea for this for Costello's homotopic renormalization. So let's see how this works. So this is the original, since Q is compatible with the symplectic form, its distribution is Q closed. So we can find something smooth, which is called a parametric, such that it's K0 equals something smooth, this is something singular, but it's K0 equals something smooth plus the exact terms, and Q is a homotopy. So once you do this homotopy, this smooth data can be used to define a B-way operator, because you compare smooth things with distributions. That's perfectly well defined, and we come back to the same setup as we have done for the toy model. So in particular, this triple is a very defined differential B-way algebra, no mathematical problem. Secondly, different choice of this regularization leads to homotopy equivalent structures. And you can write down explicit homotopy, and I'm going to call this connecting homotopy homotopic algebra flow. So this is something you can do very explicitly. And certainly, when we solve B-way mass equations, we can do this B-way mass equation for this differential B-way in this particular regularization, and using this homotopy algebra flow to connect different solutions. And that's the basic idea.
I'm slightly confused at this point. So
yes.
If KR already gives you a differential B-V algebra, and all such choices are homotopic, why do we need to pass the limit?
Yes.
Goes to zero?
This is about additional structure which is called locality.
Okay.
Yes. Okay. This is to give you a stronger conditions. And this is the a basic picture. Yeah, look at like a hat. Like anyway, I don't know this point intention, but yeah. So the original point is our renormalized point. And then you go to some regularization, some point, and do the B-way there, solve quantum mass equation, and go to another point. And then the two different solutions are connected by this homotopy RG. And that's the basic idea. And basically, use this homotopic theory to define what I mean by here. So I'm going to specify one more notion that I'm going to say the series U is finite if somehow the limit exists. So it's very similar to what it did, what it do for in algebra geometry for defining the ratitudes. Like say, you want to define a ratitude, you first you can do in the following way: deform it to a bunch of most type singularity and define a ratitude and take a limit back. And it's a very similar process. So if the lucky, if the limit exists, otherwise we just use a nearby point to define the theory. And that's the basic picture for what's going to happen. I don't mention I'm not very specific about how to take the limit, but there's some precise notion of this. In general, if it's not even finite, there will be a bunch of things happening here that you're gonna add into some so-called singular counterterm essential to do this renormalization process. But that's the basic setup. Now we're gonna use this setup to understand a particular problem, that is a two-dimensional chi-R quantum field theory, and this part comes from it's also motivated from understanding a work by a digraph for this chi-R deformation of conformal field theory. So let me start with some examples, like say this free CFT in two dimensions, like free bosons, a BC system, beta gamma system. This is a very interesting example for this CFT. Now I'm going to understand the following problem. I'm going to study the effective B-way quantization two dimensions for a chi-R deformation of this chi-R CFT of the following form. So the free part is basically this kind of free CFT, plus some kind of interacting part. And this interacting part is chiral. So this is given by some local Lagrangian density, where this involves only holomorphic derivatives of the fields, like a boson, like BC system, beta gamma system, etc. So for some simplicity, I'm going to work with these three categories. So we're going to basically understand what's happening if you do this kind of a homotopic B-way structure for this type of example. So this the solution involves a structure of a vertex algebra. That's not surprising. You know, when we do this kind of CFT, we always end up with vertex algebras. So for people who are not very familiar with vertex algebra, let me just mention quickly. So a vertex algebra is a vector space with a bunch of rich structures, basically. First one is a state field correspondence. So you start with a vector. This one can be represented on this vector space by a field, but it depends on a variable. So you get a tower of operations. And this represents the feature of two dimensions. And then you have a bunch of other notions, like vacuums, translation operators, locality, and many other stuff. So I would not mention too much. But that's the basic setup. Now, one important thing that I can do for this vertex algebra is this kind of operator expression product, OPE. So for example, we can define OPE from this field correspondence by this formula. So this is basically a way of doing diffusions for fields in two dimensions. So sometimes we only write the singular part by these notions. So because of that, I mean, basically represent the fusions, but you find the infinite towers of this product space in a consistent way, somehow remembering this kind of angles and essential in two dimensions. So that's the OPE. Now, what's going to be relevant for us is the following Lie algebra. You start with a vertex algebra, and you can get a Lie algebra of all of the Fourier modes as follows. So as a vector space, and this Lie algebra just collect all of the Fourier modes of the vertex operators. So it just collect the Fourier modes. So it's represented by our state field correspondence, this operator. And there's a very naturally defined Lie bracket on this Fourier modes, which somehow is determined by this OPE.
Sorry, this one-dimensional space?
Which one?
Sorry.
It's D?
You said something about
holomorphic coordinate, this chiral stuff. Yeah.
You said vertex algebra is some vector space with some structure.
Yes.
But then is this vector space one-dimensional?
No, it can be
Z is the variable.
Yes, this is the variable for this one, yes.
Okay.
representing the volume on the two dimensions. And then, so starting from this vertex algebra, naturally get this Lie algebra from this Fourier mode. Now here's the basic my toy model in this problem. You start with a graded vector space. I'm going to call this one H. And with a degree zero symplectic pairing on this H, then you can obtain a vertex algebra structure on the free differential ring. So AI is a basis of this vector space. You look at all the possible expressions of the derivatives. And this one has the structure of the vertex algebra. And OPEs are given by something like this. So if you look at the basis, it's generated from the basis that the OPE is between two fields. It's given by first a bracket for A and B from this symplectic form, and then look at all the one pole. And there's some factors for H bar. Sometimes we can rescale it to be one. And this example basically is an example of a combination of a BC and beta gamma system that we just started in the beginning. So that's one example. Now, let's use this setup to understand what's happening for this 2D problem. First, we consider a quantum field theory on this flat Riemann surface. This actually can be done for any Riemann surface, but for simplicity, let me work with a flat one. So this one can either be like a C or C star or elliptic curve. That's the only relevant thing for today. And this is my coordinate. This is a linear coordinate. This is a coordinate on C star. And this is a linear coordinate on this elliptic curve, up to equivalence. And with a volume form dz. Now, H is going to be a graded symplectic space, as before. So we have a degree zero symplectic pairing. Then we can obtain a B-way triple in the following way. First, the space of fields, which is the infinite dimensional space, is going to be double complex valued in this H. Secondly, the differential, we basically need a digit vector space. The differential is given by a d bar plus something else, which is represents some holomorphic differential operators acting on this field. That's something that is allowed. Then the minus one symplectic pair is given by the following. Like, suppose I have two fields, phi one and phi two, as an element here. So we first take a pairing in H to get anti-holomorph different forms, and integrate it against this holomorph volume form to get a number. And that defines it minus one symplectic pairing. And because of choice of the volume form, this is minus one shifted. And in particular, we get an infinite dimensional triple for this DG symplectic space. And then we get an effective B-way formalism, as I explained in the beginning. That's the starting point.
Is the delta something you choose?
Yes, delta something. Okay. Yes, something. It depends on the theory.
Okay.
Yes. I'll explain one example when this delta is non-trivial. So with this B-way setup, I want to understand the homotopic solution of this B-way mass equation. So at somehow the original point is described by some kind of chiral deformation in the following way. Look at the linear dual of this vector space. Again, this is going to be a degree zero symplectic pairing. And there's a natural map from the Fourier modes of this vertex algebra. We get some kind of chiral local functional on the field in the following way. Suppose formally I have some expression like this. So as I explained, this vertex algebra is generated by as a different free differential ring. So from this expression, the AI is an element of H2. This corresponds to a chiral interaction on the field as follows. So for every AI in H2, it can pair with the fields for this to kill this this factor. And then you can apply a bunch of holomorphic derivatives. That's what I mean by chiral. And then you get a bunch of anti-holomorph forms and take the wedge product, integrate against this holomorph volume form. and you get some kind of functional interactions, which is chiral. So this is a very natural map. Basically, I'm going to just work on this interactions of this type. And this is somehow, this is something like you study very carefully in diagraph situation for these chiral deformations, CFT. I'm going to mention a little bit more. So first of all, this triple, you can check. This triple defines the differential gradient Lie algebra. So this bracket is a Lie bracket for the Fourier modes I explained. And this delta is this delta, give rise to a differential. And this triple defines a differential gradient Lie algebra. Now, this is the main theorem today. So we consider the following 2D chiral CFT. So this action functional is given by a free CFT plus interaction part, where this interaction part comes from a Fourier mode of the vertex algebra as in this way. So it can be arbitrary deformation. The first four, the theory is a UA finite. This is a UA finite in the sense of I described a homotopic UA finite. So you do a homotopic renormalization, take limit back. This one exists. This is actually a little bit against the first intuition, because this works for arbitrary chiral deformation, but you might expect that from power counting, this might be divergent, but it's actually UA finite. I'll give you some examples and how to explain this one later. Secondly, because the theory is UA finite, you can describe this homotopic B-wave quantization at the original point, at the UA point. It turns out this homotopic solution of effective B-wave mass equation is equivalent to this equation, which is a Morikawa equation of the DGLA. So, and this complicated process of doing this regularization, doing B-wave and connected by homotopy, homotopic RG flow, is equivalent to the single equation. And this reason we can do this by it comes from the fact that it's a series UA finite. Finally, it can study somehow the generating functions of the theory. And the generating functions are always given by some almost holomorphic modular forms. So it's modular, but it has an anti-holomorphic dependence of the following form. So it's a finite sum of the following type. So this is holomorphic over imagine part of tau to some power. And the leading term is called a quasi-modular form. This is a very universal structure. So let me try to explain the main theorem, the 3 points, 1, 2, 3, by some examples.
Is
yes.
Three only for the elliptic curve case?
Elliptic curve case,
yeah.
Yes.
So
yeah.
Tau is the parameter of that elliptic curve.
Exactly, yes.
In three, generating functions of what?
Yeah, the partition function. So summation of all, any Feynman diagram calculation leads to almost holomorphic modular form. Yes. So I'll give you one example, a very precise example. This example that is studied from this like a two-dimensional Kolarov-Spencer theory, the cube interaction. So let me explain the point 1 and 3. So let's look at the following chiral deformation of free bosons. So this is a free boson. Look at a cube interaction that appears also in this digraph description of mirror symmetry on the curve. So let's look at this a particular diagram from this action functional. So it's given by this two-loop diagram. And to evaluate this diagram, you have to look at this propagators and look at the cube of this propagator and integrate it along this elliptic curve by this invariant measure. So this propagator for this theory is basically given by two parts. So first one is the Weierstrass P function. Second part is the E2 star. And E2 star is the E2, this is the second Eisenstadt series, which is not a modular, a mild anomaly. But if we complete this one by adding this term, which is has a mild anti-holomorphic dependence, the whole thing is going to be modular. And this is the propagator for this diagram. And then you do these integrations. So if you look at this expression, you see like this Weierstrass P function has order 2 pole. And you look at the cube, like a third power integrated, you might expect that it's divergent, and that comes from the power counting. But then you have to do this one homotopically. So you first go to a regularization and do the calculation at the regularized point and the take limit back. It turns out that this process is very smart. So let me explain what's happening. This interpretation is in journaling progress with Jeju. So let me try to give a geometric interpretation of this UA finiteness. So as you find, like this one naively looks like a divergent, like six order pole, for example. Now, what's happening if you do this homotopic renormalization? The answer is it turns out to be very simple. Has a very geometric interpretation like as follows. It considers exact sequence on, say, on the Riemann surface, or in this case, it decurved. So this exact sequence, this is like a constant shift, and this is a shift of meromorphic functions. And this is like abelian differentials of second kind. So this is like one form without order one pole. That's an exact sequence. Now, if you look at expression, you think about this term, this integrand from the Ilby curve, as a section H1 of this shift. So this one represents elements from this abelian differentials of second kind, and this is H1 of this guy. And then you can look at the boundary map, goes to H2. And this is definitely well defined. It can integrate and get a number. It turns out this map is exactly the homotopic renormalized integral for this Feynman diagram. That's this process actually works not only on Ilby curve but actually works on Riemann surface as well. I mean two-dimensional stuff. And that's the algebraic geometric interpretation of this renormalized Feynman diagrams. And also works for any graph, not only for this theta graph. Any Feynman diagram will have this kind of property. Yes? So
is this kind of equivalent to perhaps the more naive approach of writing the surface integral as a contour integral?
So, contour integrals. That's actually from the acycle integral.
Yeah.
There's my difference. I'm coming to this one. Okay. Yes. This is exactly different from your description as well. So I'm coming to this. Yes. So yes, this is exactly the point. So using the boundary map, you can compute this renormalized the integral. You find so-called almost holomorphic modular forms. So E2, E4, E2 star, E2 star. So the whole thing is modular, a particular weight. Now, to connect to your question, so naively, there's a so-called tau bar goes to infinity limit. And in this process, basically, it amounts to somehow replace this E2 star by E2, because you look at this expression, this is a relation. So when we set tau bar goes to infinity limit, this term will basically drop out. So in this limit, this almost holomorphic modular forms will become this kind of so-called quasi-modular forms, E2, E4, E star. And this become acycle integrals, loop integrals. That's a relation. Yes. It only appears when you take the tau bar goes to infinity limit.
Yes.
And this is an integral that's computed by Michael Douglas, if I understand correctly.
Yeah.
But this process has a nicer interpretation in the fact that you start with some kind of like acycle integrals. If this one comes from a two-cycle integrals, obviously this is going to be has a modular interpretation, so it's modular invariant. In general, if you look at complicated graphs, I mean, you take this process, you'll find a bunch of combinations of acycle and bcycle stuff, and similar to the Riemann bilinear relations. Somehow, this is a different version of what physics do for this point-splitting method, I guess. But I find this interpretation very helpful in understanding this structure. So this explains the fact that the theory is UA finite, and actually all the Feynman diagrams compute from this stuff is given by some kind of almost holomorphic modular forms, which has a nice tau bar goes to infinity limit. That's the point one and point three. Now let me come to explain the point two for this quantum mass equation. So I can explain by example. And this is an example for this quantum B model. So as I mentioned in the beginning, like there's a generalization of Clausius-Spencer theory that we find to complete this kind of B-wave structure in the sense of a Tsinghua. So the field content of our B-theory theory is given by the complex. So this is a polyvector field with a formal variable t, and this is differential. And you can think about this stuff as representing divergence-free vector field, preserving the volume Calabi-Yau structure preserving the Calabi-Yau volume form. So this is a basically homotopy version of this volume preserving vector field. So we're gonna gauge this guy. There's a very precise classical theory for this one. We write down action functionals and satisfying classical mass equation, so on. But let me just explain what's happening for the curve example. This is going to be very precise and explicit. So we specialize to this elliptic curve case. Now, then the polyvector, you only have vector field. There's no two polyvectors, so you have this come from these two components. The first one just double complex. Second is double complex valued in this holomorphic tangent vectors, the shift degree by one. And we're going to write this whole complex in our 2D setup as a double complex tensor with a degree zero. Actually, it's going to be a graded Poisson stuff. I will explain. So this H is given by this vector space. So you see this T remembers T, the theta remembers this additional Fermion. So I use this grading, like degree T is zero, degree theta is minus one.
So minus T, I mean in the physical sense, is T
the Coupling constant? The T is a gravitational, for this gravitational descendant.
Right, okay.
Yes,
okay.
Yes.
T is what?
For this gravitational descendant, yes. So T to the K is the K's descendant, for example. Now, we got this chiral stuff. Now we got a differential. The differential in our previous page is given by this one, but if you do this one explicitly on this setup, it's d bar plus the T delta. This delta is given by this operator, which is like a divergence operator. So it kill one vector and do one holomorphic derivative. Now, the subtle thing here is that this one, the B-wave kernel in this case is degenerate. It's a degenerate B-wave theory. So I just explained to you the B-wave kernel in terms of OPE because in my setup for this 2D stuff, the way you use this parent is basically to define the corresponding OPE. So the OPE for the field is the following. So if you represent a field from this double complex by a sum like this, so this big K is represented this K is descendant for this from this data, and this is like from this this data. So you have infinite many of them. It's very big data. Then the relevant OPE in this example is given by the following: so the B naught has a non-trivial OPE by 1 over z minus w squared. So this represents the fact that this is correspond to a derivative of a free boson. And all the other OPEs are zero. So you see, like, this is a very degenerate situation. So from this fact. So in particular, got is a degenerate B-wave structure. So also from this expression, you can say, like, this B0 is dynamical, but all the other fields, when BK for K bigger than zero, and for the eta fields, all of them are somehow background fields. So that's the data for this degenerate B-wave theory. Now, using the main theorem, you can prove the following: like there exists a canonical solution quantum mass equation for B-theory theorem on elliptic curve. This quantum mass equation is in the sense of a homotopic renormalization. I explained, and the theory is UA finite, And then the way you describe the solution of quantum mass equation is by solving a Morikawa equation in the corresponding DGA of the free modes of the vertex operators. And you can analyze the deformation obstruction complex for this DGOA. And this is computed by using the boson Fermi correspondence to relate this bosonic stuff to easier Fermi calculation. And then after you do this one, if this theorem comes from a very simple observation on the corresponding cohomology. So in particular, this will lead to a solution of quantum B model, a higher genus invariance on the elliptic curve. So let me tell you something more explicitly what's happening. And because we have a very precise description of this quantum mass equation in terms of vertex algebra, we can do this the example very explicitly. For example, I will just write for you the formula in the so-called stationary sector. This is a notion that is mirrored to a so-called stationary Gromitian invariance. In this B model setup, this stationary sector amounts to basically freeze the background fields. So by setting like BK equals 0 when K is bigger than 0, and all the eta fields are constant. So this all of these are background fields and freeze it in this way. Then you solve this quantum mass equation. It turns out that the solution is very explicit. So this is a formula, but the first part is a free boson, which represents the dynamical field of B0. And the eta k is a constant, become a coupling constant. And this kind of interactions has a formula in the following way. The WK, it looks complicated, but it's a very standard one in physics. It corresponds to a bosonic realization of this so-called 1 plus infinity algebra. So this one, the classical limit of this one is given by B0 to the kth power. And you get quantum corrections for the higher genus from.
The eta k
is actually yes.
It's
good question.
Even
it's all in this process, but at additional degree from this double complex. So it has two components. One is even, one is odd. So you have to look at the combination of this. So in this expression, this one represents the odd part, but shifted by the 0-1 form. So it becomes even in this set. Yeah. Setup. Yes. Now, but this is solved by you solve this the DGRA so explicitly, and that's what you find. So, now what's the meaning of the quantum mass equation in this case? It turns out that if you write down this homotopic B-way quantum mass equation at the U-way point, and this quantum mass equation is equivalent, as I said, it's a DGRA, but because the background field is phased, I mean the Q doesn't do anything. So it becomes this equation, so which says like all of these vertex operators they commute. So that's somehow how this equation is solved, basically. You interpret this quantum mass equation in terms of these commuting operators, and you can solve it uniquely, basically. And if you look at a classical limit of this, if you look at classical limit, then you see, like from this expression, the classical limit is B0 to the kth order. And it just represents this kind of classical Hamiltonians. And the classical limit of the equation is the following. Like if you look at a commutator, the bracket of this Hamiltonian functions, you see the Poisson bracket in this way. So this is the classical limit of the OPE equation. Then all of them commute. That's the classical limit of this equation. And this is the infinite number of commuting Hamiltonians that I stated in the beginning of this lecture by the simple formula e to the u over t. And they expand it, you find that Hamiltonians. This is going to be true in general for any club I will explain. So now let me move on to generating functions. So you can look at these generating functions for this quantum Tsinghua theory, you get basically correlation functions for this cohomology. As I explained, the generating functions are given by almost holomorphic modular forms. And in particular, they have a very they have a Taubach dependence, which is a famous holomorphic anomaly. And secondly, like to match with the which the A site on the mirror symmetry, like involves a process in physics called the Taubach goes to infinity limit. I just expressed this limit in the example for the cubic deformation of the free boson. So if you take a Taubach goes to infinity goes to infinity limit of this quantum BCU theory, the stationary sector can be computed by a trace because they reduce the this 2D integrals by some acycle integrals and some characters on these vertex algebras, and this coincides with the stationary Gomertian invariance on the mirror as computed by Okenkopf, Pandora, Panda. They express the formula in terms of free formings, and this the formula holds at the mirror is expressed in terms of boson Fermi correspondence. So this gives you the higher genus mirror symmetry example.
Sorry, so just to make sure,
yes.
So this is a generative series in eta k's and b0 only, right?
Yes, this is eta k's.
Okay, so
but b0, this is only a stationary sector. Yes.
I'm just saying this is the same set of variables that you would come up on from a Quinton theory.
Yeah, for the stationary sector, yes. The same setup mirror, yes. But to get general functions, you need additional, like a Virasoro equations to get the full generating function. But somehow the stationary sector plus Virasoro determine the whole thing anyway. So you can using this one, you can prove this higher genus mirror symmetry for all the possible insertions of descendants and so on. So basically this generalizes the work of Dagrath on this cubic case, if I understand correctly. So now let me some remarks. Now, I just explained that you observed evening many of commuting Hamiltonians by this expansion formula e to the u over t. And that expansion formula comes from some kind of point case or a singularity. So one way to understand what we have been doing in this elliptic curve example is by understanding the interaction of this speed model as a trivial map, like a point cross a elliptic curve goes to the elliptic curve. This is trivial enough, but it's not that trivial because point has interesting intersections for Gomertian invariants. And in general, if you consider the following map, x cross elliptic curve to an elliptic curve, where x is any Calabi-Yau, can be compact Calabi-Yau or some kind of a Landau-Ginzburg model. And basically you compactify along x. And using this B-wave setup, this one will lead to some kind of effective 2D chiral theory on the elliptic curve. And this is a very naive case. Then if you do this compactification, you compute the leading effective action, you'll find the infinite many commuting Hamiltonians, which turns out to be Dvorak-Zhang's principal integrable hierarchy. Mm-hmm. And that is a work in progress with Wei Changhe and Filson Yu. where we do this, establish this kind of a compactification process for this B-way thing and integral hierarchies. And again, if you do this process for Landau-Ginzburg twisting, you do this, and then this BCU theory can be coupled with a superpotential. And this classical BCU theory somehow is equivalent to so-called a Saito theory of primitive forms. Again, the leading effective theory for this infinite many commuting Hamiltonians somehow is computed by replacing this exponential map by the so-called primitive form. So if you do this primitive form from this Landau-Ginzburg theory, you expand it, you find this infinite many commuting Hamiltonians as an effective theory for this two-dimensional case. And the B-wave mass equation guarantees that they're going to be commuting anyway. And that's how you derive the Dvorak-Zhang's principal integrable hierarchy. And finally, there's a generalization of this story. Like, you can couple BCU theory with Witten's Holomorphic Simon theory, that is open-closed stuff. So, I probably just won't say too much about it. So thank you very much for your attention.